I like the outdoors. I like walking in the mountains. I also like running as a recreation. I got to nearly the age of 30 without knowing that fell running existed. When I did, it just felt like a sport that had been made for me, and I was, you know, I just fell in love with it. The thing I remember as my first experience of fell running, it wasn't actually a race. It was a sort of practice for a 24-hour endurance event, and it was just meant to take about 5 or 6 hours. And what I remember was doing it with some friends who had some experience of it, and initially thinking, this is just easy. It's such fun. You just go up the hills very slowly. It's quite a nice day. A bit cloudy at the top, and then you get to the top and you go down, and it's really good fun. It's all, you know, grassy, not too steep. But the trouble with it was that it went on and on and on. And, you know, after 3 or 4 hours, I found that my legs were giving way, and it was getting a bit tougher. We were getting sort of lost in the cloud a bit. It was getting a bit cold. And I really got to the stage where if I'd been running on the road, I would have thought, you know, I might give up at this point and try and get a bus home or something like that. But of course, if you're up in the middle of the mountains, you know, miles from anywhere, you don't have any choice but to keep going, no matter how awful you feel. And I can still vividly remember, you know, the agony of just forcing myself to hobble on for hour after hour. I mean, really, so I could not stand up, literally. I remember finally coming down from Scarfell to Wasdale Head Car Park, and this last descent just seemed to go on and on and on forever. And I would sort of stagger and sway for 5 minutes and then just collapse on the ground. I mean, I just was crawling. I was sliding down on my bottom. I just couldn't carry on, and somehow I had to. And my final experience was somehow getting to the bottom and sort of crawling into the car park and promptly throwing up. I mean, it was a fairly, fairly extreme and unpleasant experience. But at the same time, having done it, I never really looked back. I sort of fell in love with the sport there and there.
Which brings us on to the Bob Graham round.
Okay, well, the Bob Graham round is named after a bloke called Bob Graham, who was who ran a guest house in the Lake District in Keswick. And in 1932, he set an extraordinary record for the number of peaks climbed in a 24-hour period. And it was his 42nd birthday, and he climbed 42 peaks, which is a distance, I think it's estimates vary, but it's around 70 miles. And then, yeah, for 30 years afterwards, other people tried to do it as well, and no one could else manage to do it. It was considered to be, you know, just about impossible. And, you know, in the post-war years, in the sort of 1950s, when people were trying to climb Everest and to do the 4-minute mile, the sort of third great challenge that everyone was looking at, which sometimes the same people were looking at, was the Bob Graham round. Could anyone else get round this thing again? And it's not just a question of stamina to keep going for, you know, that level of ultra running just to keep going for 24 hours, but it's also the, you know, navigating, not get lost, not getting hurt, the sheer toughness and agility and courage needed just to keep going in the mountains no matter what the conditions. You know, the next person did it in 1960, I think it was, and then bit by bit another person did it. By the early 1970s, I think there were 4 people who'd done it, and or possibly 5 by then, and they formed a club. And then gradually, as with Everest and as with the 4-minute mile, as the years went by and the psychological barrier had been broken, more and more people thought they'd give it a try as well, and gradually more and more people started to do it. By the time I first tried, I think, you know, nearly 1,000 people had done it altogether ever. You know, the first time I tried, and you know, I got about 2/3 of the way around and just collapsed horribly, and it didn't work. And then I tried again and I tried again. It took me 4 attempts. You know, I was very inappropriately unsuitable for doing it, really. I mean, most people who are good at fell running and long distance fell running are people who live among the mountains, who've lived all their lives among the mountains. You know, it helps to be very light, you know, sort of 8, 9, 10 stone maximum, to be totally fearless and to be, you know, super fit. And I was this sort of, you know, 13 stone southerner who'd spent the best years of my life smoking and had weak ankles, and I was terrified of heights, so I really wasn't remotely suitable for it. But there's just something about it. The scenery is so beautiful, people were so nice and friendly, and having, you know, set out to do it, I just felt it can't be that difficult just to keep putting one foot in front of the other for 24 hours. And you know, eventually, after many years of trying, I managed to do it as well, and it was fantastically rewarding and satisfying experience.
What inspired you to write your book, Feet in the Clouds?
I realised that, you know, some of the greatest sporting heroes that Britain has ever produced, of all kinds, were fell runners, and no one has heard of them. And really, you know, outside the fell running counties, or perhaps even fell running villages, people had, you know, barely heard of people like you know, Ernest Dalzell or Bill Teasdale or Joss Naylor or Billy Bland or Kenny Stewart. And objectively these were right on the same level as, you know, the Olympic gold medalists. It's just that because fell running's a sport that doesn't really have any money in it, they've never become nationally famous. And I just felt that if someone didn't write all this down and try and give outsiders some idea of what these people had achieved, you know, it would all gradually get forgotten. I mean, one of the things I like about fell running is that it's such an uncommercial sport. It's been fantastic watching the Olympics and everything like that, and fantastic, inspiring performances in the Olympics and the Paralympics. And, you know, lots of people would like to get involved in more sport after that. But I think we're constantly getting sold this message that, you know, in order to do sport properly, you have to spend enormous sums of money on, you know, the latest equipment, the latest sponsor-approved drinks and clothes, and it's got to be in the right stadium, right? And it's sort of sport and running has slightly become this sort of incredibly commercialized branch of the entertainment industry, and it sort of excludes vast sectors of the population. It just seems to me that someone needs to speak up for the idea that running is, you know, one of the most natural activities known to man. It's, you know, like walking or singing or swimming or sex. It's, you know, one of life's great free gifts, and you don't have to spend lots of money to enjoy running, and you don't have to just do it on the pavement and in the park and in the sort of specially approved mass participation race. You know, there's a whole countryside out there that is largely ignored by runners, and, you know, there's an enormous amount of pleasure and fun and satisfaction to be had.
And lastly, and most importantly probably, are you still running yourself?
Oh yeah, I'm still running. I mean, I'm probably not very fast. I don't know. I'd hardly bothered to measure myself these days, but I'm nearly 53 and I still run every day, and I think the secret for me is that I enjoy it. You know, I don't obsess about how fast I'm going or my body fat percentage or my pulse rate or anything like that. For me, you know, running is all about just going out and enjoying the world around me. You know, that must be one of the most important fitness secrets of all, is that if you enjoy what you do, then you'll keep doing it.